Alright, welcome to my presentation. So, I'm going to introduce you guys to the wonderful world of Hans Bohr Gadamer. So, in this talk, this is going to be on the philosophy of experience. My name is Jack Knetemann, I'm a philosophy and religion double major, and I'm a senior. So, my goal with this talk is I want to open your guys' eyes to unexpected experiences. Because sometimes things happen, and you don't know exactly what's going on. And your gut reaction is to turn away from it, or run as far away as you possibly can. So, how are we going to do this? My first stop is we're going to talk about preconceived notions. So that's the approach to the experience. Second thing we're going to talk about is the art of the question. And that's how you collide with the experience. And the last one is horizons, or how to actually have a dialogue with the experience. Now, most of life is pretty ordinary. Things just pass along as they go. No real surprises, and kind of, humdrum, whatever. But sometimes things happen, and you're not sure exactly what's going on. And it's at these times that you can actually learn something sometimes, as long as you have the right side of ears and eyes on and are open to it happening. So, I hope in this talk, you'll learn to open your ears a little bit wider. So you might be wondering, what is going on with this song? So this guy's name is Anthony Braxton. He's a jazz guy from the 70s and 80s and 90s and 2000s. He's still alive, so. But he likes to mess with people. He likes to mess with people's expectations. So if that's your first question, is what is going on? Well, I'm just forced to into an experience, so I hope you're enjoying yourself. The second question you might have is, how fast can I get to that door and get away from this ruckus? Well, I'm talking, and the courtesy says that you can't leave until I'm done, so, I mean, as long as I feel like it. But I'm going to turn it off for now. I'm going to turn Mr. Braxton off, and we're going to talk about experience, what going through an experience is like, and how to have a more genuine one, so that we can enjoy this big world of ours a little bit more. So, let's get talking. Yeah. So this is my talk. That's the title. Remade Horizon, Gadamer and the Philosophy of Experience. It's a long title, so let's break it down. First thing is Gadamer. Hans Bohr Gadamer was a philosopher. He was born in 1900, and he died at the ripe old age of 102 in 2002. He wrote a book called Truth and Method, and Truth and Method is in the realm of hermeneutics. So that's a really fancy term, but it comes from something that you guys might know. Has anyone ever heard of Hermes? All right, who's Hermes? He's a messenger.
Not a guy.
He's a messenger guy. He has little wings on his shoes and he delivers messages. So, hermeneutics is the study of interpretation. It's how to interpret a message, how to get your message across to someone, and how to get what they're trying to say out of it. So that's what this book's about. So then, that's what Gadamer, he did lots of stuff. He lived for 100 years. But that's his main thing. Philosophy of experience. So what do I mean by experience? I don't just mean like a normal everyday thing, or like, college is an experience. That's true. It's also a very long experience. I'm talking about particular things. So you go see a movie, you read a book, you have an interesting talk with a stranger, something like that. And the last one is Remade Horizon. So by the end of this talk, it's going to make a lot more sense what I mean. But when you see these two ladies, they got their, if you imagine, that these are their spheres of understanding. This is the things they know and the things that they can talk about. And there's a connection between them. So how do you get a full connection with someone? How do you really get to know someone better than normal? That's what an experience is, and that's what I hope you understand by the end of my talk. Prejudices. That's our first part. Your prejudice. Sorry about it. Your prejudice. Everyone in this room is prejudiced, and you all might feel a little bad about yourselves. Well, this isn't a sociology lesson. I mean something different from prejudice. I don't mean these types of. That's what we normally think. So I don't mean people that negative things. I mean, certainly these people are prejudiced, but what a prejudice is much bigger than that. And Gadamer wants to reconsider what our thought is on prejudice. So it's not always negative. His concept is, here's Mr. Gadamer, there he is that prejudice is any preconceived notion. It's just any idea we have in our heads before we actually meet something. So, nice little quote from Truth and Method. A judgment that is rendered before all the elements that determine a situation have been finally examined. So that means You don't know exactly what's happening, but you have some concept of what it is. So that's how it applies to, you know, these bigot bunches of people. But it also applies to you guys coming to this lecture. You expected someone to come up and talk. It'd be pretty weird if I came up and just played jazz the whole time. That's not what you're expecting. So, any preconceived notion. That's what prejudice is. So why care about this? Why think about this? Because prejudices determine what your how you interpret something. It's your starting point. So imagine that prejudices affect everything that you're going to interpret. So let's say you go watch a movie, and you watch a movie, and you're expecting to be entertained, and it's a happy movie the whole time. And at the end, the romantic figures don't end up together. You're going to be mad because you had a prejudice that said, you know, these people are supposed to end up together. Well, that's not the way it has to go. I mean, movies can have any type of plot direction. It doesn't have to end well. I mean, it's always nice when it does. But it can go any way. So your prejudices are going to determine where you go. Now that has two problems. So Einstein has this quote. This quote is, common sense is a list of prejudices acquired by age 18. So what he means by that is we get these ideas in our head about how things work, and we stick to them. That's like our understanding of something. And in my opinion, that's why people who are in their 50s still listen to music that happened when, you know, they're in their 20s. Like, because they got used to a way the music works or whatever works, and they stick to it. And that's it. If it doesn't come out of that, it's some weird movement that they don't understand. So we get complacent and we cling to the ideas that we've already gained. Well, the problem is that everything we come across is different. You're never going to have the same experience twice. So you're using these notions of things, how things work, based on something that hasn't happened yet. Things are always going to be a little bit different, and you need to be able to adjust and work on them. So Mr. Gadamer has this wonderful idea called forward projection. So his idea is you're always projecting. You always have prejudices, and you're always projecting them on the things that you're coming into contact with. The point is not to stop this. It's not to become some unprejudiced robot interpreter. Because that's just a prejudice against prejudice. So if we're controlled by these prejudices, we want to keep a good grasp on them. We want to know what they're doing and how they're shaping our interpretation, how they're shaping our taste. So forward projection is where you start. It's when you guys heard, so I step into this room and I start talking. It's your initial response. That's not the response to who I am and what I'm going to say. It's just a response to my position, you're running with other talkers, yada, yada, yada. So what his point is that forward projection is not the end. Forward projection is constantly revised in terms of what emerges as he penetrates into the meaning. So when you meet something, to have a proper understanding of it, you have to recognize that I have all these prejudices and I have this forward projection that I'm running into. And that's not what this thing I'm running into is. I do not understand this thing. If you think you do, then you're not going to have an actual connection with it. It's just going to be what you've already seen. You're not going to recognize it for the unique experience that it is. So you need to adjust it. That's what this quote is talking about. You need to say, okay, I have this idea of what it is. I know it's similar to it. How is it different? And then you work from there, and you progress along this path of understanding. You go deeper and deeper down the rabbit hole, and you really get at what's going on. So that's how you understand things. You start at a forward progression, you start at a place, and you go further. How to do that? Questions. Questions are the way to doing it. Gadamer loves questions. I love everything about them. He thinks that questions, all knowledge leads through the question. That's the way he thinks. You can't learn something unless you have a question about it. Scientific method. Everyone remembers fourth grade science, or not, but hopefully remember that. It starts with either you ask a question, you make an observation, or you make an observation, you ask a question, depending on which textbook you're reading. But either way, the question starts it. Right? So you need to ask questions about something. When I had that the Anthony Braxton piece at the beginning, and that trumpet guy started to just go, woo! You can either, that was pretty good, right? Yeah. You can either turn away from it and not ask questions, just be like, I want to get as far away from this trumpet guy. Or you can be like, what's going on? Like, what's this trumpet doing? Why? you inquire about. And that's how you're going to actually get to something. Now, what type of questions? There's many types of questions. Anyone who's ever been quizzed, like anyone who's ever seen anything about poll questions knows that you can slant your questions. So Gadamer wants to get away from this, because slanted questions don't actually lead to understanding. You want open questions. So here's an example of slanted questions. When we had Anthony Braxton blaring down your eardrums, and you say, "What's that?" The implication of that is it shouldn't be happening. That's why you say it in a negative tone. So that's not slanted, because you're not trying to meet it anywhere. You've already come up with the answer yourself. You want an open question. What is that? What's it trying to do? What's it trying to say? What's it trying to accomplish with this trumpet? That's going to open you up to what he's actually trying to tell you. It's not what you're not trying to hear. You're actually trying to inject it. And that's how you're going to actually meet him. So the last part of the talk is on horizons. Yeah, everyone's horizons. So what happens here? It's the sky meeting the earth. So first notion of a horizon is it's the meeting point. It's where you meet the thing you're interpreting, whatever it is. So you want to have a broad connection with something. You don't want just some type of surface thing. I mean, no one wants to have small talk the entire time. But I'd argue some people have small talk with music and art their whole lives, and you don't really get to the basis of what's going on. So to refer back, you have the forward projection, you ask questions about it, you ask questions about the thing you're running into, and you get deeper down, you have a deeper connection. So that's the first part of horizon. That's the first concept that he has. The second concept is on expansion. So horizon isn't just where the two meet. It's also as far as your eye can see. You can't see past the horizon. But not all horizons are the same. I mean, the horizon in Harrisonburg is, you know, a couple thousand miles. If you go out to North Dakota, you go out to Big Sky Country, you can see for, I don't know how far, I've never been up, but it's very far. So you can expand your horizons. You can see farther. You can learn more. I learned something from you. If you teach me how the theory of relativity exists, I have a better understanding of what's going on in this world. You can learn more, and that's going to make you more likely to get a connection with something. It's going to make you more likely to ask better questions because you have a better idea of what's going on. That's going to teach you, and that's the hermeneutical circle. That's why you can never stop learning. And understanding is a fusion of horizons. When you actually connect with someone, you actually are understanding them. And that's a beautiful thing. Infinity. Now, some people treat knowledge as some type of mountain. And you learn, you learn, you learn, you learn. And then you get to the top of the mountain, and you understand everything. You know everything. I mean, everyone's talked to that person who thinks they know exactly what's going on. That person does not know everything. Because, like what we already established earlier in the discussion, everything's new. Everything's always going to be different. So you can keep learning for infinity. You can keep understanding something for infinity. I hope that with this talk, you don't just learn to take things that you never knew, songs, new books. I hope you don't just learn to give them a fair shot. But also, whatever your favorite album is, go listen to it again. Whatever your favorite book is, read it again. Books aren't supposed to be read once. They're supposed to be returned to. Because you can get something out of that thing for the rest of your life. So let's recap really quick, and we're going to do a little experiment. So we started with, not that one, we started with prejudice. So we started with prejudice. You start with someone. You start with your four projection. You have to recognize what's guiding that are a list of notions on things that you think is how pieces go. You recognize that that's not how this thing is going to go. That's a new experience. It's something that's going to happen differently. So you question it. You question your understanding of it. You question what the person is trying to say. So you can get farther, deeper, and have a broader horizon. And that's how you have a full experience. So now that you guys are pros on how to have an experience, let's try to have one real quick. All right. So when we walked into this building, I played for you an Anthony Braxton piece that people had different responses to it. So you don't know exactly what's going on and probably turned away from it.
You had a computer up at the top where it said next select song.
Next select song?
It's open now.
Maybe it is. All right. So what we're going to do is I'm going to play this song. This song is by Miles Davis. Does anyone know who Miles Davis is? That's a pretty good man, right? He's the guy in the sweet jacket who plays the soothing, sexy trumpet solos, right? So Miles Davis had an album come out in 1972 called All in a Quarter, and that's what we're going to listen to. And it's not that. It's very different. So with this new approach, I hope you can understand where your preconceptions have led you, question it, and try to understand what Miles is doing. I bet you're going to really like it. Thank you very much.